that down just a bit. Merry Christmas, everybody. I'm going to share with you a story. Not a fake story, it's a real story. It's a story of my life. And I'm going to put a Christmas twist on it. But the name is, Can You Feel the Pain? And so while that doesn't sound like a Silent Night, Holy Night type of Christmas, it's real. It's real talk, okay? Because in the inner city, there isn't Silent Night, Holy Night. I'm not sure if there is anywhere. I'm gonna start with my mom. My mom, she came here from Europe. She came during a time that she was held in refugee camps. They had to leave their homes. And when she was in refugee camps, they gave them soup to eat that was already turned to bugs. Many of the people in there with her didn't make it because they couldn't eat it. I mean, young people especially refused to eat it. Their moms couldn't get them to eat it. My mom never had a Christmas like we're talking about. You know, one of those Silent Night, Holy Night type of Christmas. She had to run for her life. That's what she had to do. My grandmother escaped and she got her children out of there. I think that's where I get my determination from. She wasn't a quitter. She didn't lay down and die. She did what she had to do to save her family. My mom met my dad, and her life quickly improved. My mom was like a beauty queen. She had a sixth grade education. My dad was a doctor of chemistry. So they balanced each other out. But my dad got sick. He got cancer. See, I was daddy's little girl right there. He got sick with cancer, and for 8 years, until I was 12, we were in and out of the hospitals. He'd stay as long as he could, as long as the insurance paid, then he'd have to get out, go back to work, and then go back, and then come out. And so where I spent a lot of my Christmases was in the hospital. That's where we celebrated, in the hospital next to my father. But even in his pain, even in his agony, he was the greatest father that there was for me. He still took us places. He took us camping. And I can remember him leaning up against the wall of a Walgreens because he was in so much pain, but he wouldn't say it to me that he's in that much pain. Can you feel the pain? Put reverb, please. Turn her up. My mom wasn't the only one that was hurting, though, over my father. Because my father was, he was the supporter. He took care of us. He brought balance to our lives. I was daddy's little girl. He would try to tell me things at a very young age because he knew he wouldn't be there. He would try to tell me about the birds and the bees, and I don't know what he was talking about because I was just too young. But he wanted to tell me because he wanted me to know, and he knew he wouldn't be there. He used to put me on his feet, and you know how you do that with your children and you spin them around? He used to dance with me because he knew he would never be there for my first dance. He wouldn't be there. He would tell me that I needed to stay a virgin. He would tell me that I needed to stay in school. And I'm just looking at him and I'm wondering why he's saying all this, because it didn't make sense to me. I would be laughing, but he would have tears coming down his eyes. I went to see him like I did every year, amen? Spent my graduation there, my eighth grade graduation, spent Christmas, spent Easter, spent everything there. And when I got to his room this time, it was different. My mom was there, she was there for 2 weeks and didn't come home. And every aunt and uncle that I had was in that room, and I knew something was up, I knew something was different. And I started to cry, and a nurse came up and she grabbed me by my arm, and I'm begging her, please let me go, let me go. She goes, you can't be in here. And I said, that's my father, let me go. That's my father. And I started screaming for my dad to help me, but he was unconscious and he couldn't help me. She pulled me out of the room and I thought, that's fine. I'll just go back tomorrow, right? No big deal, this is what we do. 4 a.m, the phone rang. My grandma picked it up. And there was no conversation. All that happened was her head went down with the phone. And I stood there, 12 years old, wondering what just happened, but knowing in my heart, my dad just died. That I would not have the opportunity to go back and see him. And something happened inside my heart, something that I don't think I felt prior to that, and that was rage. I hated that nurse for depriving me of the last time that I could have spent with my dad. Can you feel the pain? Well, I'm a mess, you can see. I didn't want to live, let alone just do what I do, go to school. I started using drugs and drinking. You know how we do it. I didn't even have to do it. I met a man, you see, I wasn't using heroin, but he introduced me to it, and he would tie up my arm. I didn't have to do it. He would get the needle. He would get the dope. He would cook it up. He would draw it up. And the first time that I used it, I thought I felt peace. But that peace quickly turned into a long addiction. But there's one thing that I kept saying. Today's my last day. I'm not gonna use tomorrow. Today's my last day. I'm not gonna use tomorrow. Can you feel the pain?
Can you feel the pain? Can you?
I'm 15. I'm hanging with a rough crowd. I look like a little girl. I still look like a little girl. But this guy, he was much bigger than me, and I was a virgin, and I didn't want to have sex. I did not want to have sex with him, but he didn't care. He didn't listen to me. He was like over 6 foot, maybe 6 foot two or three. And so he overpowered me, but I'm thinking I could look at him in the eyes and that he would see humanity, that he would see that I really don't want to do this. Please, I'm a virgin. Don't do this to me. Don't do this to me. He didn't care. That night, you know, my dad, I promised him that I would stay a virgin. And so that night, that man didn't just take my virginity, he took my dreams. Can you feel the pain? I'm about 18, 19. My boyfriend's maybe 19, 20. He had been stabbed. And he wanted to get high. I begged him not to, because he was already number three. He got delirious. We were at his mother's house. And when she saw how high he looked, she threw us out of his house. And I don't know where he took us, but he took us to a friend of his. It was out of Chicago. It was out of the city. It was an undeveloped area. I didn't know where we were. I tried to take him down. I tried to put him over my arm and carry him down the steps, because I could tell that he's not looking good. Never thinking that he's serious, but that he needs to go to the doctor. And so he wouldn't go when he was conscious, but when he was semi-conscious, I could coax him and get, drag him down the stairs. My Jeep, which we drove there with, had four flat tires and was pushed in a ditch. It was Halloween night. I put him in anyway, and I thought I could ride it out on the rims. I just needed to get him to a hospital. I tried to ride him out in the rims, but it just dug deeper and deeper and deeper into this dirt. I took him out. I put him back in the house. His friend came home. He worked graveyard shift, and he finally came home, and he knew where a phone was, because I was running down the street screaming for somebody to open the door. Please open the door. I need to make a call, please. And nobody would open it. No one would let me in. No one. Down the whole street. So when he got back, I was relieved. He called an ambulance. The ambulance came. And I'm thinking, all right, everything's good now, right? And they took him to the hospital. I followed behind in a different car. And when I got to the hospital, they just had me fill out papers. Papers and papers and papers and papers. So I'm thinking everything's fine. They're working on him. I'll just fill out their papers. A nurse comes in. It was an hour and a half later. And I jumped up and I said, "How's Steve?" And she said, "Steve, he was dead on arrival." I hit her. You know, I already don't like nurses. And I was arrested. I was taken in for involuntary manslaughter. Can you feel the pain? Quarter of my original youth group are doing life sentences. And when the first one, there's no clip, there's nothing in the chamber, so just everybody relax. No more pain here, okay? The first one that shot up a house, I asked his friend who was also in our youth group, why did he do it? And he gave me an answer that startled me. He said, we're in my kitchen talking. He said, Pastor, our parents are on crack. Our moms are messed up. We don't have clothes to eat. We don't have food to eat. And we're powerless to do anything about it. But he said, when I pick up a gun, he said, when we pick up a gun, I'm talking about this kid that just went to jail. I wasn't talking about we. But he said, when we, he said, and I put it to somebody's head, I have power. If I say move, they're going to move. And then he said something else that stuck with me up until this day, and I live my ministry by it. He said, Pastor, what I'm really saying is this. If I put a gun to someone's head, what I'm saying is, can you feel my pain? I'm saying, why can't we feel it before they pick up a gun? Why can't we feel it? Why can't we feel it? Years are going by, and I'm doing all kinds of jobs. I'm selling cars. I'm servicing cars. I'm working at this place called the Rodeo Bar. I'm working as a ballroom dancer. I didn't know who I was. I was just lost out there. Just looking for who I am, trying to find purpose, trying to prove that even though I'm strung out on heroin and cocaine, I have purpose. I'm good. I'm trying to prove it, but I didn't recognize back then that it didn't matter what I did. I had purpose just by existing. God loved me. 14 years. And I'm still saying the same thing. Today's my last day. I'm not gonna use tomorrow. It was around Christmas. And I knew I'm gonna use tomorrow. You know, you get to the end of a dream, pipe dream. And after Steve died, I didn't care anymore. You see, those cops, they kept me up all night. They interrogated me all night. They kept asking me the same questions, thinking I'm going to give different answers. But you know what? I did not care. Lock me up. Please. You can't tell me about me more than I'm telling myself. You can't tell me that I took someone's life because I felt it myself. I felt I should have been able to save him. I felt like I should have been able to do something. I could have worked harder. I don't know. I didn't know. I tried everything I knew that night. Everything was against me. So after that, something, you know, it's a gradual death. Death upon death upon death. And after Steve, I just was numb. No more feelings. Went through a bunch of treatment centers, but always went right back out. after my suicide attempt, I was out on the streets again. And 1 year from that hospital stay, I was at my drug dealer's house like I was every day. There was a raid on the house, and I had something in my hand. I tried to hide it because the doors didn't open. The doors came down. They came in from every which way you could come in a building. And they looked at, they took me down first because they thought I was going for a gun. And they said, make a move and I'll blow your brains out. I said, blow my brains out. Somebody has to help me. Somebody has to help me end this miserable life. I tried to take my life, but it didn't work. I felt that death didn't even want me. That death, I could do anything. And death wouldn't take me. You see, what I didn't know then, I know today that when God has a plan for your life, you can't even take your life. Any of you been betrayed? Turned by your closest friends that said, I'm gonna be there, I'll always be there for you. And the minute you walk away, they're talking behind your back and they're not there for you. This person experienced the same thing. He was betrayed by those that were closest to him, those that promised that they loved him. He faced the crime that he did not commit. He was hung between two thieves. Talking about Jesus, can you feel the pain?
Can you feel the pain? Can you
keep going? Martel, have to ask myself. Monica, did you know? Did you know? Did you know that Jesus was born to die for your sins? Did you know that it was taken care of already? The past, the present, and the future, it all goes on the cross. I didn't know that. I remember Christmas where, without my dad, the first Christmas where my brother took the tree and he threw it across the room because he was filled with rage. It wasn't holy, nor was it a silent night. It was an angry night. Mary, did you know that the child you're carrying, that the child you deliver will one day deliver you? We look at the baby Jesus and we don't think, what can the baby do? Well, I'll tell you, that baby can do a lot when his name is Jesus Christ. Yeah. Nothing could change me. Nothing could touch me. I was dead. And I'm so grateful that Jesus is in raising the dead, because that's what I was. I was dead. I had no purpose. And that last, not the last photo, second to the last, you could see that I was like skeletal. And it was the last Christmas before I attempted suicide. And I knew I would not go back to my mother's house because you could see the tracks. I wore something like this, only it was down to here, so that she couldn't see. But how can you not notice someone that weighs 70 pounds maybe? Somebody that was down to 70 pounds, like a look of death in their eyes. There's no life. How can you expect your mother not to notice? You know, we try to play the game. My mom would wait and wait and wait and wait and wait and wait for me to make it there for Christmas dinner. And I never got there on time because I always had to get straight before I went there. But that year, I tried to cover up because it was the worst. Tracks that went up, down here, down here. Two weeks after that, I knew I don't want to do this anymore. I lost my job because I was embezzling. I had nothing to do but just shoot up that money. No purpose in my life. And I decided I had it. I'm through. I listened to voices in my head that said, you'd be better off dead. You're an embarrassment to your family. You're an embarrassment to your mother, to your brothers. They're ashamed of you. They never said that, but the voice in my head did. That night, I tried to take my life. I took two bottles of barbiturates and a fifth of vodka. I was serious. I wasn't playing. I wasn't leaving a note. I wasn't planning on being alive. That was my last Christmas. I was so angry. I threw everything off. I just threw everything off the tables. I pulled the phone out of the wall. I dropped everything that was in my house. I just threw it. I was so angry because I could not make it. I could not succeed in this thing called life. I couldn't beat it. I wasn't worthy. I just wanted to die. And that's what I did. I laid down to die. And woke up in a hospital unconscious for 4 days. You see, to this day, I don't know how I woke up. But somebody had a word of knowledge for me in a different city. And they described my living room. They described what I was doing. They described what I was feeling. And there was no way they could. And then they said, and you don't know why you're still alive. She goes, Jesus wants me to tell you that he was right there with you. When you were running through that house, he was right behind you. When you were throwing things off the tables, he was right there with you. He had you covered the whole time. Even though you didn't know him, even though you didn't recognize him, he was there. See, Jesus died for our sins. After I got saved, I went to Bible college. I was working on Wall Street in New York to make money to go back to school. And there was a boy in the Bronx that died. He spilt his blood all over Grand Avenue. It's coming out like a fountain. He put his fist through the window, and he hit an artery, and he was bleeding to death. And he was screaming three words, somebody save me, somebody save me, somebody save me. I couldn't get those words. It was 4 a.m, and I couldn't get those words out of my mind. When I woke up later in the morning to go to work, I saw the police tape put up, and I knew that boy died. And they were photographing just huge pools of his blood. I went and I told the traders on Wall Street that I worked with about this boy in the Bronx. And they told me to shut up. They didn't care about a troublemaker. It's another troublemaker dead. And I realized that they didn't know who they're talking to. They didn't realize, even though I told them my testimony, it went right over their educated heads. It went right over. Because the way they were talking, they obviously didn't get it, that I was not always like this. They only saw the Jesus makeover. They could not imagine where I came from. When I went home that night, I'm crying out to God. Nobody cared. That boy spilt his blood all over Grand Avenue for nothing. And God reminded me of another. You can pick them up. Another that spilt his blood all over Calvary. He spilt his blood for businessmen who say, who cares? He spilt his blood for drug addicts. He spilt his blood for prostitutes. He spilt his blood for people with pride. He spilt his blood for all of us so that we can have life and have it more abundantly. Put that one picture with Iffy. I'm going to close. Jesus changed my life. I finished Bible school. I helped plant Minnesota Teen Challenge. I went on to plant 7 other inner city churches just like this in 5 major cities. Now you tell me how that girl who couldn't do nothing for any length of time can for the last 25 years, 27 years, be doing the same thing, planning churches. I should have been left for dead. I should have been left for dead. Instead, I'm bringing forth life. We serve a good God, people. And you're not here by accident. You're here by divine appointment. God is speaking to you. The holidays can be hard times. It's when we remember people we lost. It's hard to get through. It's hard, even harder if you don't have money and the pressure that's on you. If you're here today and this is what you need to know, is that Jesus is coming back. And he's coming back for his bride, those who are confessed him as Lord and Savior of their lives, his church. But maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I'm not sure. I'm not sure if I'm right with God. Don't leave without being right with God. Maybe you're here and you know exactly that you're not right with God. Don't leave without praying with me. Bow your heads with me. Put on what can I do? Because this song speaks to me. Because I can't breathe without him. I can't walk without him.